Grazie.
Grazie.
Sì. Vabbè, dovete fare il vostro lavoro. Non è per me necessariamente facilitarlo.
Oh là là. Buongiorno a tutti. Abbiamo due giorni intensi qui in Vaticano, oggi e domani, con un tema impegnativo. Rethinking Europe, a Christian contribution to the rethinking of the European project. Abbiamo visto in questi anni diversi interventi del Santo Padre in merito a questo, e le discussioni certamente seguono questa scia della sua preoccupazione, forse si può dire, non so se è una parola troppo forte, per l'Europa di oggi, con un mix molto ampio di persone, accademici, diplomatici, politici, ecclesiastici e altri. I nostri ospiti oggi sono ben conosciuti, Cardinal Marx, l'Arcivescovo di Monaco, se non anche il Presidente del COMECE, e Monsignor Paul Gallagher, Sua Eccellenza, che è il Segretario per i Rapporti con gli Stati. Cominciamo con Cardinal Marx, sì, che parla in tedesco, però avete, se non lo avete, potete prendere il testo in italiano che è appena uscito in bollettino, poi Monsignor Gallagher. Cardinal Marx.
Ja, meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, danke, dass Sie sich Zeit nehmen, um sich zu informieren über unseren Kongress, der in Rom stattfindet, aus Anlass auch des 60-jährigen Jubiläums der römischen Verträge und gemeinsam organisiert vom Heiligen Stuhl und von der COMECE, der Kommission der Bischofskonferenzen der Europäischen Union. Wir sind sehr froh, dass das möglich ist und wir hoffen, dass wir einen kleinen Impuls geben können für die Weiterentwicklung Europas. Die Europäische Union und ganz Europa steht vor großen Herausforderungen, die nicht auf Europa allein beschränkt sind. Auf die Bürger von Politikern und der Politik, wenn schon nicht abschließende Antworten, dann doch eine deutliche Zielsetzung und Perspektive erwarten. Ich will nur wenige Herausforderungen aufzählen. Der Klimawandel und die damit einhergehende Notwendigkeit, mittelfristig unseren nicht nachhaltigen Lebensstil zu verändern. Damit verbunden ist auch die Frage nach den Kosten des ökologischen Wandels und der Verteilung der Kosten. Ein weiterer Punkt, die zunehmende Veränderung in der Arbeitswelt durch Digitalisierung, durch den Einsatz von Robotertechnik, durch prekäre Arbeitsverhältnisse und vor allem durch die hohe Jugendarbeitslosigkeit in einzelnen Ländern Europas. Mit all dem verbunden ist die grundsätzliche Frage nach dem Wert der Arbeit und der Würde des Menschen. Die in der sogenannten Flüchtlingskrise deutlich gewordenen Flucht- und Migrationsbewegungen. Menschen suchen Sicherheit und Schutz vor Krieg und Terror. Sie sind auf der Suche nach besseren Lebensbedingungen oder nach besseren Lebenschancen als in ihrer Heimat, die ihnen keine Perspektiven zu bieten scheint. Die Ursachen für diese Bewegung sind vielfältig und unter anderem auch in Europa zu suchen, in unserer Lebensweise, die oft jetzt und auch in der Vergangenheit auf Kosten anderer geht. Nachhaltige Lösungen und Antworten bedürfen eines umfassenden Blicks. Erkennbar ist eine Neigung, angesichts dieser großen Herausforderung die Antworten im Gestern zu suchen, in einer falsch verstandenen Rückkehr zum Bewährten, die oft doch eigentlich nur Nostalgie und romantische Verklärung der Vergangenheit ist. Auch populistische und rückwärtsgewandte politische Strömungen sind ein Ausdruck dafür. Das ist aber nicht unsere Perspektive. Es geht nicht um den beschönigenden Rückblick, sondern es geht um einen klaren Blick auf unsere Gegenwart und vor allem auf die Zukunft. Deshalb steht unser Dialog unter dem Leitwort Rethinking Europe. Das Re ist nicht rückwärtsgewandt, sondern im Sinne von Erneuerung, erneut noch einmal auf Europa schauen. Die Europäische Union, Das Projekt Europa hat Großes bewirkt. Die Europäische Union ist nicht identisch mit Europa, aber sie ist so eine Art Nukleus für den ganzen Kontinent, für die Entwicklung des gesamten Kontinents. Dieses Projekt hat in den vergangenen mehr als 60 Jahren zu Frieden, Solidarität, Aufbau und Fortschritt in Europa wesentlich beigetragen. Gleichzeitig haben viele Bürger der Europäischen Union ein distanziertes Verhältnis zu diesem Projekt entwickelt. Die Europäische Union erscheint zunehmend technokratisch. Menschen erwarten fast in einer konsumistischen Haltung einerseits alles von Brüssel und sind enttäuscht, wenn sie es nicht bekommen. Andererseits erwarten sie sich oft gar nichts mehr, sind aber zugleich nicht bereit, dieses Projekt Europa zu ihrem eigenen Projekt zu machen. Angesichts dieser Herausforderung und der komplexen Situation stellt sich die Frage, wie und was kann die Kirche beitragen, um Antworten zu finden? Wir verstehen uns ja als Mitpilgerin auf dem Weg der gesamten Menschheit, also auch der Menschen in Europa. Wir haben keine fertigen Antworten und Lösungen und wir sind auch nicht zuständig für die konkrete Politik. Aber es erscheint uns notwendig, die Menschen in der EU mit ihren unterschiedlichen Erfahrungen, mit ihren unterschiedlichen Erwartungen und mit ihren reichen und unterschiedlichen Begabungen wieder stärker in den Mittelpunkt des Projektes Europa zu stellen und sie zu befähigen, damit sie Akteure Europas sein können. Das ist auch Inhalt und Ziel dieses Treffens in Rom. Wir wollen Politiker und Vertreter der Kirche ebenso wie Vertreter gesellschaftlicher Organisationen miteinander ins Gespräch bringen über Europa, über die Europäische Union, über Erwartungen, Hoffnungen, aber auch Enttäuschungen. Die leitende Frage lautet dabei, was können wir, was wollen wir miteinander tun, um gemeinsam in diesem Europa zu leben und das Projekt Europa voranzubringen. Deswegen haben wir uns überlegt, kein klassisches Kongressprogramm zu organisieren, sondern einen Dialogprozess. Das ist ein gewisses Experiment, aber wir hoffen, dass es gelingt. Nach einleitenden Podiumsgesprächen zu den Themen, die von Papst Franziskus in seiner Rede zur Verleihung des Karlspreises genannt wurden, werden wir dann in Kleingruppen arbeiten. Ausgangspunkt ist also diese Rede. Es wird ja morgen dann die fünfte Rede des Papstes zu Europa sein. Das ist schon bemerkenswert. Aber wir haben die Rede zur Verleihung des Karlspreises einmal herausgegriffen mit den drei Punkten, die besonders wichtig waren im Blick auf Europa. Erster Punkt, Integration. Es geht auch darum, wie gehen wir um mit den Brüchen und Verwerfungen in und zwischen den Mitgliedstaaten der Europäischen Union. Der zweite Punkt, Dialog und die Verfassung einer europäischen Demokratie. Ein dritter Punkt, die Kraft zu erschaffen, die Kreativität, in besonderer Weise auch, wie wird eine Wirtschaft aussehen, wie können wir uns eine Wirtschaft der Zukunft vorstellen, die diesem Aspekt gerecht wird. Und das wollen wir in Kleingruppen am Samstag, am morgigen Vormittag, austauschen und viele Stimmen hören und wir möchten, dass alle sich aktiv beteiligen. Diese Analysen, Ideen, Vorschläge werden gesammelt und weiter diskutiert. Das Treffen ist nicht ein Abschluss, sondern Einladung zu einem weiteren Nachdenk- und Diskussionsprozess über Europa und die Europäische Union. Wir verstehen das als einen Auftakt, auch als einen Auftrag an uns in der COMECE, daran weiterzuarbeiten. Wir haben auch gestern schon in der Plenaria der COMECE darüber gesprochen. Wir werden im Präsidium der COMECE und der Vollversammlung weiter überlegen, wie wir den Dialog auf verschiedenen Ebenen zwischen der Kirche und der europäischen Politik noch weiter intensivieren können. Da ist schon vieles geschehen. Ich bin ja jetzt fast 6 Jahre Präsident der COMECE und es ist immer wieder voller Mühe, aber auch immer wieder mit sehr positiven Elementen und Erfahrungen versehen. Der Kontakt wird ja auch von der Seite der Politik und der gesellschaftlichen Gruppen gesucht. Von Papst Franziskus erhoffen wir uns zum Abschluss unseres Treffens Ermutigung und Bestärkung, diesen Dialogprozess mit Blick auf die Zukunft Europas und der Europäischen Union fortzusetzen. Um bei einem Bild von Papst Franziskus zu bleiben, in seiner ersten Rede zu Europa vor dem Europäischen Parlament hat er Europa als müde, als erschöpfte Großmutter gezeichnet. Das hat auch Kritik gefunden. Wie können wir dazu beitragen, so denke ich, dass diese Großmutter trotz der Runzeln ihrer Jahre, trotz ihres Alters, eine liebenswerte Person ist, die nicht erschöpft das Erreichte bewacht und verteidigt, sondern die den Reichtum ihrer Erfahrungen an die folgenden Generationen weitergibt und sie ermutigt, vertrauensvoll mit diesen Erfahrungen ihren eigenen Weg in die Zukunft zu gehen. Wir wissen es zu schätzen, dass Papst Franziskus morgen seine 5. Rede zu Europa und der Europäischen Union halten wird. Alle seine Reden haben bisher bemerkenswerte Denkanstöße gegeben und sind auch in der Öffentlichkeit, auch in der politischen und gesellschaftlichen Öffentlichkeit, positiv aufgenommen worden. Und diese Rede wird auch für uns natürlich in der Arbeit bedeutsam sein. Und wir hoffen, dass wir mit diesem Kongress und besonders auch mit den Worten des Papstes ein Zeichen und ein Zeugnis der Ermutigung und der Hoffnung für Europa in diesen Tagen geben können. Dankeschön.
Grazie, Eminenza. Eccellenza Monsignor Gallagher.
Grazie, dottore Berg. Grazie per l'invito a partecipare a questa conferenza stampa. E come il direttore ha detto all'inizio del nostro incontro stamattina, la preoccupazione e l'interesse di Papa Francesco sono ben noti dall'inizio del pontificato nella questione Europa e nel progetto europeo. Ma possiamo dire che questa è stata una preoccupazione e che i papi nei tempi moderni hanno sempre riservato un grande interesse e preoccupazione per Europa. E questo è, vediamo, testimonianza nel libro che l'ambasciata dell'Unione Europea ha pubblicato in questi giorni, presentando interventi dei vari papi dai tempi di Paolo VI fino a Papa Francesco in questi giorni. Ecco, è già in questo pontificato, in 3 momenti particolari, il Papa si è mostrato questo interesse, la sua visita a Strasburgo, anche la celebrazione qui a Roma, in quest'anno del Trattato di Roma, nel suo 60° anniversario, e adesso con questa conferenza. E questa preoccupazione è già evidente nel fatto che la Segreteria di Stato ha voluto accogliere l'invito della COMECE di essere parte di questo evento molto significativo per la Chiesa. Perché mentre finora in questo pontificato il Papa ha reagito piuttosto alla realtà politica, sociale dell'Unione Europea e di Europa in genere, questo momento è quando noi come Chiesa accogliamo l'opportunità di dire quale contributo possiamo fare noi a questo progetto europeo, in questa realtà europea che troviamo oggi. E così è questa la nostra intenzione. Siamo molto felici dell'organizzazione di questa conferenza. Vediamo che questa conferenza non classica, come il Cardinale ha detto, va a essere piuttosto un esercizio di dialogo tra tutti, diciamo, rappresentanti delle chiese, rappresentanti anche dei cattolici impegnati nella politica e nella vita dell'Unione Europea. E così speriamo che questo dialogo che lanciamo in questo momento, che sperimentiamo in questi 2 giorni qui a Roma, sia anche aiuto per l'Europa e per le sue istituzioni, e anche in questo momento che è assai critico, come sappiamo tutti noi, per il futuro di questa Unione, per l'Europa stessa. Perché forse il dialogo è la cosa che qualche volta manca. Ci sono tante parole, ci sono tanti incontri, però come sappiamo bene, incontrarsi
parlare non è la stessa come dialogo. E noi crediamo fermamente che un dialogo affettivo e effettivo è necessario qui in Europa per rianimare. Papa Francesco sempre ha molto insistito sulla necessità di rigiovenire questo nostro continente, di riscoprire i carismi dei padri fondatori, di rianimare l'istituzione. E il Papa e la Santa Sede siamo convinti che questo sia possibile, che Europa è in grado di affrontare le sfide, le varie sfide che sono anche pure gravi in questo momento. E così vediamo questa conferenza Rethinking Europe, un contributo cristiano all'Europa di oggi, come un momento importante quando noi andiamo, sì, prendere note della situazione, però anche progettare un futuro e soprattutto un impegno cristiano cattolico anche per il futuro dell'Europa. Vi ringrazio per l'attenzione.
Grazie Eccellenza, adesso a voi. Rimaniamo in Europa, se possiamo. Grazie. Nome e testata.
Sì, Alberto Bobbio di Famiglia Cristiana. Volevo fare una domanda a entrambi, sia il Cardinale Marx sia Monsignor Gallagher. Lei, Eminenza, ha parlato di nazionalismi e di populismi in modo con una critica forte. Volevo chiederle, non mi pare questa la posizione di tutte le conferenze episcopali di Europa? Penso alle differenze nelle analisi da parte, per esempio, dei vescovi polacchi e alla manifestazione del Rosario ai confini che ha suscitato polemiche nei giorni scorsi. Volevo chiederle una sua valutazione di questi nazionalismi che tornano, Austria, Repubblica Ceca, con anche velature neonaziste, e il fatto che a volte quegli episcopati sono d'accordo con queste scelte politiche.
I think you cannot go through the episcopates and they have resolutions against for Europe, but we have a common sense about what is social doctrine of the church. You cannot quote one bishop in a sermon and then say, that is the meaning, the opinion of all the bishops. We are discussing, and you are right, the word populism and nationalism is also to interpret. Now you have to, what do you mean? And so the question is right, what do I mean? When you have the idea that your nation is higher, is better than other nations, that is not Christian. That's not according to the Christian faith. When you say, love your neighbor like yourself, that's Christian. You have also to look on your interest, that we are not naive about the situation, and Jesus was not naive. But we are all brothers and sisters, and all human beings are image of God, all. Faithful or not faithful, Catholics or not Catholics, they're all equal in being human beings. So what is the problem? Sometimes we have learned, it's growing the thinking in black and white in some movements, and that's clear. And I cannot say that bishops' conferences are following these lines. I would not say that I cannot read this in resolutions of bishops' conferences that they are following populist and nationalist ideas. No? But when I would have to criticize it, when it is the case, I have not seen it. I cannot follow every sermon of every bishop and priest in every parish. That is not impossible for me. But we are here in a group of European bishops. We discuss, and especially the migration crisis was a great point to discuss also in our group of 20 27 or 28 bishops. They are elected from their bishops' conferences. The situation in the countries is difficult or is different. Not all have the same situation. But in the great line, we are following the Pope. We are Catholic. So the line of the Pope and the line he is underlining in his speeches is the common line of the Church.
Sì, credo che toccando il concetto prima di nazionalismo, esiste un sano nazionalismo che normalmente si esprime con senso di patriottico, patriottismo. Questo è, incoraggiamo sempre questo, perché sia con nazionalismo sia con populismo c'è sempre qualche compromesso con la verità. Perché in un populismo i politici presentano quello che il popolo vorrebbe ascoltare, non necessariamente tutta la verità o tutto quello che devono comunicare. Il nazionalismo, come ha detto il cardinale Marx, ha la tendenza di esaltare a pregiudizio degli altri certi aspetti della vita nazionale o certe caratteristiche della vita nazionale. E così credo che noi, e fa parte secondo me anche dello spirito cattolico, che noi cattolico con un senso di universalismo, per quello che la Chiesa ha sempre avuto una grande simpatia per il progetto europeo, perché questo attraverso le frontiere, attraverso le realtà nazionali e guarda verso un'unità maggiore, un'unità di tutti. E evidentemente questo è in perfetta armonia con la nostra fede cristiana cattolica. E così credo che la posizione. Che ci siano differenze politiche tra il popolo di Dio e tra il clero, che siano vescovi, sia il clero, è perfettamente normale. Ognuno di noi. Ci sono vescovi che hanno più simpatia per posizione, diciamo, socialistica, anche vescovi che hanno più simpatia per posizione conservatrici. Questo è anche normale. È per quello che la Santa Sede raccomanda di rimanere fuori della politica partitaria. Per questo, e noi in genere, questo è sempre una posizione, uno può avere sua opinione. Però anche dobbiamo dire che la politica come una scienza è tutto relativa, non è come la fede o morale in cui la Chiesa esige o propone le cose che verità. Queste sono questioni di politica, è una questione di prudenza, di valutare le cose nel modo migliore. È per quello che evidentemente un nazionalismo non sano è sempre da scoraggiare. E il populismo come, diciamo, strategia politica è poco consigliabile. Grazie.
È una differenza fra patriottismo e nazionalismo. In Germania noi diciamo wir sind Patrioten, aber nicht Nationalisten. Una differenza. And the great tragedy of Europe was nationalism. That was the great tragedy. And the next year we will have 100 years after the First World War. And when you read also some sermons on both sides, on France, in France and Germany, you are shocked 100 years later. I will not judge about the people 100 years before me. I have not the right to do this. But when you read the text, you are shocked. And we will never have this. I want never have an idea like this, that we are fighting against each other because of these nationalism non sano.
Salve, buongiorno. Io sono Elise Harris con Catholic News Agency. Se va bene, io chiedo la mia domanda in inglese. I would like to ask, you guys mentioned that the future of Europe has been a concern for all popes kind of in modern history. You have Benedict that talked often about concern regarding an increasing secularism in Europe. And Francis speaks often about the need to go back to Europe's Christian roots. But with the kind of incoming migration crisis, there's also an increase of the presence of Islam, and with this kind of a sense of Islamophobia that's increasing. So in your guys' opinion, what role do you think with this as a backdrop, what role do you think religion can play in the future of Europe, and how can we leave space for it in society while overcoming prejudices and not trying to eradicate those we disagree with?
We thought several years ago, 20 years ago, that religion will disappear. That was the conviction of many sociologues and politicians. They say when the society will progress, then religion disappears, secularism. That's not the case. The religions will be very important for the 21st century. We see it. The discussion about religion is there. It's one of the great subjects of the future. And so your question is very important. What role will religions play? Will they be an instrument of peace and dialogue or of confrontation? And I think for the Christian faith, for the Christian people of God, it's very clear. We are instrumental. The council said we are sacrament of unity of all human beings, not only for the church. We are not only for us. The Pope is underlining this. No, we are not narcissistic in ourselves. We are part of a solution for all human beings. So I think that is very important. That the Catholic Church, the Christians are playing an important role. It's not depending of their growth, of their how many we are. That is another question. That is not the only question. But have we something to say? Do we something for the future of the human beings, not only for us? Sometimes I ask in the parishes when they ask Cardinal, what's about our future in the parish? And I say, better to ask, what is the future of the world? What is the future of the human beings in your city here? Perhaps it's also important. And then we will be heard. I do not see that the church is less interesting the public world. You see, Pope Francis is a very, very good example, but we are not all Pope Francis, that's clear. But you see, when someone is speaking authentically and is open for compassion, for being with others, then they search people like this. I think it's a great chance also in the 21st century for the church in Europe. The religions, how to organize, that is the great question. Also a dialogue between religions, perhaps the Holy See is more competent to speak about this. But what will be the answer? We have to try it. We have to speak with the other religions, especially with the Islam. And he's part of the European history in Spain and Albania. It's not a new situation. So we cannot say the presence of the Islam was never in Europe. That is not the case. It was always a dialogue, discussion, war. It was not so easy, but there was a relationship. No? And so for the future, I think the church, the Catholic Church, has to play a very important role to find ways of dialogue, ways of relation to this religion, which is very important for the 21st century. And also in Europe, I think.
Yeah. The days when you could say we don't do religion are over. Many diplomatic services throughout Europe and elsewhere are now running courses, literally accelerated courses to make up time on the questions of religion, world religion, the role of religion, etc. And the world is becoming aware that it is the world that is a very religious place. Number of believers goes up continually. But that, of course, brings with it great responsibility for believers. And therefore, I think we do have to take that responsibility very seriously and make sure that religion is making a positive contribution, and that religion, and one might say even Catholic religion, is part of the solution and not part of the problem. Um, But I think we can be optimistic about that, because that there is this growing awareness of the positive things that religion does and the recognition of it. I don't think we should be too worried about statistics and numbers, and I think we have to stick to principles. If we believe in religious freedom, then religious freedom is valid for a Hindu, a Muslim, or anybody, as it's valid for a Christian. So even if numbers go out, and there is a great degree of often disinformation and scaremongering about the sizes of Islamic communities around Europe as well. The numbers, the percentages sometimes are not quite as great, big as the populist politicians would lead us to believe. But so I do think that religion is increasingly going to have a positive role, A, because we do recognize that some of the liberal, secularist thought that was part of much of our societies is not in good health either. What we have to do is, I think, to try and combat a lot of the political correctness that exists within Europe, where, and also the fact that there is still a tendency to kick religion into the private sphere and not allow it to be part of the public debate. But this is something which we obviously have to work on, but, and is a work in progress, but I think there is a change of atmosphere now, and certainly a degree of willingness on the part of many of the European actors and institutions to engage with those who are religious. It puts a great responsibility on religious leaders. Of that there is no doubt. And we have to be consistent, and we have to be clear. And also, we have to be very make every effort to avoid that there shouldn't be conflicts between religions and between denominations, and rather that we should see ourselves very much in the mold that we believe and we have faith, so that we may serve. Thank you.
My fear is not that religion will disappear, but will be instrumentalized for other reasons, for political reasons. That will be perhaps the great fear for the 21st century.
Phil Pulella from Reuters. Part of the title of the conference is the European Project, and there is also participation by some high-level people from the European institutions, such as the Parliament and the Commission. I'm wondering, how long a shadow, if any, will Brexit cast over this conference, seeing as one of you comes from the country that is leaving and the other one comes from perhaps the country that tried the most to convince Britain not to leave?
I must admit that in our conference, in our plenary in the last year, that was a main topic, you know, because we wanted to understand what is happening there, why people said, a majority said, the campaign was a little bit complicated, but I have not to judge about the campaign in Great Britain, but why people say we are not following this project more. And so the discussion was very, very intensive, also with our colleagues from Scotland and England and Ireland. And it is a subject. It's clear that when you have had the experience of a progress and a greater union year for year after the great revolution of 89, and then a greater union, and then a very important member is leaving, that's not easy to understand, but we have not to judge the decision of Great Britain. I'm very sad about it, and I think many people also in Germany and in other countries are not happy about this. But we have to respect it. What can we do? But I feel also after this discussion about Brexit, about these yeah, it was a, for me it was a shock. Now the opportunity to think again about Europe is there. No? So also you have the two points: the disappointment, that's clear, a divorce, no? A little bit is not a happy thing, a happy event. But then you say, what is my future? What will we do together? Will we be friends? And what is with the future of Europe when Great Britain is a partner, a friend, but not member of the Union? So also an encouragement for the others to rethink Europe, I think. That was also, my feeling is like this, that's also a moment that they are rethinking what's about our future now. And you see, we have had great speeches, I would say. As a bishop, I can say, yes, I'm not a politician, but the speech of Jean-Claude Juncker, for example, and also President Macron, there is a new language to encourage to go further, to go forward. And that's good. Britain.
Well,
speak as the Vatican.
My personal position before the Brexit vote is well known and on the record. I think we have to try and make the situation work that we find ourselves in now. I think we have to point out, and in fairness, that the United Kingdom is leaving the Union, not leaving Europe. And there are different ways of being in Europe. And it doesn't mean that you necessarily abandon all the elements of the European project just because you leave the Union. I don't think it's, from my looking at the program, I don't think it's going to be a dominant theme in the discussions of the next 2 days. I think it forms a little bit of the background of some of the difficulties that the Union is facing, and that those things have to be faced. And I think what we will be doing is trying to, as I say, make a Christian contribution to this situation, as one does to any other critical situation in life. What can we do to make this work, to make the dialogue go forward, and to see that all the parties at the end of the divorce are in better shape than they were before. Thank you.
Vladimiro Rengio, settimanale Nigela. E qualche settimana fa Papa Francesco alla messa di a Santa Marta, parlando della schiavitù di Israele in Babilonia, ha detto, commentando le scritture, non c'è la nazione, non c'è il futuro della nazione senza identità. L'uomo senza identità non ha futuro. Lei, Eminenza, elencando gli argomenti da discutere, ha elencato le cose molto tecniche: clima, lavoro nell'era digitale, migrazioni. Ma non ci sono i problemi anche legati alla sfida dell'identità che rimane aperta? È una cosa nostalgica del passato, romanticismo, come ha detto lei, o una cosa essenziale? Grazie.
No, that's not a point of nostalgia. That's very important, no? But you cannot easily define identity. It's a very complicated word. It's used, but when you say, sometimes I say, when I was 10 years old, I was the same Reinhard Marx. But my identity is not perhaps 100% the same. So it's identity is a difficult word, I would say. And so I'm a bit, I hesitate to make it in the to use it in a very simple way. A nation, a free nation of different religions, different cultures, or different ages of people. How can they find identity? That's a great discussion. The discussion is important, I would say. The discussion is important, but it's not simple. It's not very, when you are decided for a free society, you have to accept that one is Christian and the other is leaving the church, and you have people who are who came from Italy to Germany, or and they are here since three generations in Germany, and you have different opinions, political parties, traditions, also in Germany between Bavaria and Berlin is very, very difficult, not so easy. So it is not clear for me what does this mean. One nation of 80 million people has an identity. I would say I hesitate to use this word. We have a common culture. We have a common common sense to live together, to respect each other, the law, the traditions, the feasts, the celebrations. So there's a many, you have to say many things, but they are open. We learn. It's not a stable thing. It's a living culture is not stable, static, is a living culture. Also Heimat. I had the discussion in Germany, Heimat, homeland, that's a special German word, Heimat. And it's good that we are discussing it. I think I said to our president, who used this word in his speech about the German, the celebration of the German unity several weeks ago, and I said to him, yes, it's good to use this word, but Heimat is not a stable thing. We are living our homeland in action, in greetings, in celebrations, in it's a development. So when you underline this, I accept that Europe has a common culture, but is also very multicultural. When you see the reality of Europe from Spain to Russia, from many places, also in the classes of the society, many differences. The nobles of the old times and the simple population, it's the language and many things. So it's important to speak about this, but it's not easy to speak about. I would underline.
Michael Fit, Münchner Merkur. Eminenza, una domanda un po' connesso alla domanda di identità. Stiamo osservando in Europa non solo i nuovi populismi e nazionalismi, ma anche una nuova onda del separatismo. Stiamo osservando questo al momento in Catalogna, ma anche qui in Italia abbiamo visto il referendum qui alla Lombardia e al Veneto. Ci esiste una posizione comune della COMECE su questa vicenda, in particolarmente sulla Catalogna, ma anche sulla questione dei nuovi separatismi in Europa?
I think it's a question about two aspects. One aspect is what is the future of the national state, and we have some national states who were organized in the 19th century and the 20th century, perhaps not in a way. I would not say that Germany is the leader, but we have our experience that when you have a national state without federal institutions, without autonomy in the different cultures of the country, that's perhaps not easy. So the national state is in some parts of Europe a new question, how to organize a national state and the different traditions and languages. In Spain you have different languages, also in France and so on. That will be a question to find also in the states the line of the principle of the church subsidiarity. Perhaps that I'm not against it. We have the great tradition in Germany that the national state is not the only reality, but the different Länder and experiences and are very, very important, very independent or autonomous. And that's important. But that must not be to leave this common sense of one nation. But when you have not found the right equilibre with in the country, perhaps, but I cannot judge the situation in the different countries. The other point is the discussion about the future of democracy. Because many people, I said it in relationship to Europe, they have the impression, what is this? I have no control, I have no influence. And I think it's a very important discussion, what is a good democracy for the future, no? And that they feel not they are not involved in the political process, so they are against it a little bit. The two aspects, I think, the sign of separatism gives is a sign for problems in these two questions: national state and federalism, subsidiarity, and the functioning of a modern democracy involving the people, making them participate in the political progress. That's, I think, that are important questions.
Bene, grazie Eminenza, Eccellenza, grazie. E Sua Eminenza Marx rimane per un po', se una televisione ha bisogno di una battuta, sarà in salottino. E grazie a tutti.
Grazie a voi.
Also. Herzlichen Dank. Ja.
Bitte. Ja.
So. Okay. Setz mich nochmal hin. Wir haben einen da.